Yeah, hello guys. Next topic is PSQL. So guys, if you remember the introduction about SQL whenever we are going with, so I used one particular statement that SQL is an open source. The different companies, they had customized this particular SQL language. They included their own features and they formed some new product, right? So this SQL Server contains this PSQL language. PSQL language is similar to PLSQL in Oracle. So where here you can write programming blocks, similar kind of script in SQL also. So now, first of all, in this video, I'm going to cover you how to write different anonymous blocks. So after that, you can try to understand how to create stored procedures, functions, triggers, and all those things. Okay, so this is what the content we have in SQL Server. So the basic SQL, whatever we learned so far, the same syntaxes, you can use it here also, as I mentioned. So as I covered, if there is any specific changes, I already mentioned in these previous videos also. So now let's start with anonymous blocks. So guys, you should remember one thing. Whenever we are writing about a TSQL statement, there will be four blocks, not only here, even in PLSQL also. So you will contain four blocks actually. So the first one is declare block. The second one, begin. The third one, exception. The fourth one, end block. So this begin is like our open bracket for the function. This end is like our close bracket of a function. So exception is optional. Declare is an optional. So only mandatory things are begin and end are mandatory for writing anonymous block. First of all, let us start from the scratch again, how to declare a variable and how we can perform different operations with a variable, that we can see it now. So we have a declare block. So no need to write capital letter. You can write small letters also. I'm just highlighting the word. So A, so as a type integer, normally in C language or C sharp, we are going to write int A. It is going to be in reverse order. So whenever there is single at the rate, guys, that is user defined variable. Whenever you have double at the rate, this is going to call predefined variables. So predefined variables will have two at rates. So user defined variable should have only single at rate. Remember this point clearly. So now in case if you want to pass some value, you can directly pass by using an equal to symbol. Okay. So after that, you will have a begin and end block. As I mentioned, exception is optional. If it is required, we can use, otherwise we can ignore it completely. So here there will be two things. So either you can write select at the rate A, or else you can also use print at the rate A. So print is for developers, guys. Whenever I use select statement, that is going to be the result of this particular script. So print is will be used for error solving methods and all those. So as of now, don't go with this. Even if you use this, nothing, you won't get anything new. So let me execute this. So this first 50 under seeing result will comes with select statement. Under messages, you can see the 50. This is comes with print statements. So remember carefully. So whenever you want to display something to user, you should use select. Whenever you want to write some comment or hints, whether the program is executing, script is working properly or not, you can write comments by using print function. So this is how you can create a variable, and this is how you can print it on the print it by using a select statement. So guys, as I said, this is going to support our programming blocks and programming syntaxes. So you can use some of the programming syntaxes like if else, all these things you can use. Suppose I just want to check whether this A is even or not. So you can write if at the rate, there is a function mod of A comma 2, then begin. So I can print select, I'm using concatenation, is even. So like the same, if not else block, again else will have begin end. Here I am going to print A is odd. So if mod is not working, let me use a percentage let us use mod only. Why we should go all this? Mod a comma 2. Now let's execute. It's giving wrong statement, guys. Mod a percentage 2 equal to 0. Sorry, equal to 0, not double equal to. So now you can see. So I hope you understand, right? So a is an integer, this is a string value, so you cannot concat it directly, so that you should use convert function. Convert, we should convert it into integer, sorry, varchar, and you can pass this at the rate symbol. That's it. Now a will become varchar type, so that we can concatenate directly. So now you can see the result. So 50 is even. Like the same, if I give 51, I can see the result as odd. 51 is odd. So like that you can write if else statements. Okay, and one more thing, guys, you can also perform switch cases. So switch cases in the sense, suppose this is I integer 1. So switch cases can be written like this: select case when, sorry, select when 1, then it should print 1 received. It like you can call switch cases. When 2, then to received. So like that, whenever you want to write else wrong input, after completing the case you can use end again. So case is starting and end is the ending, so in between you can write this when clauses. So now if you see, so in the output 1 received. If I use 2 here, 2 received. So if I give 20, so wrong input you can see. Like that you can write switch cases also. Okay, so now you should understand one thing here. So since we are going to write some script, there is no problem at all, but this script is going to be cleared when you close this particular editor. I mean, when you close the software, you are going to lose this script again tomorrow, I mean next time whenever you want to work with. Again you have to type all these particular clearly again. The script need to be written again and again. That is the reason we are moving to the concept called stored procedures. So stored procedures are functions are similar to the blocks whatever we wrote just now. These are called anonymous blocks. There is no name, these are not going to be saved in the database permanently. So that is the reason we are using this anonymous blocks. So that is the reason we are going to use this storage procedures. So where these are going to be saved in our database permanently. First of all, let us try to understand how to write stored processes, then we can see functions and all those. So the syntax is, whenever you want to create a stored procedure, you should remember one thing. I am going to tell you the differentiation. Stored procedure will support all type of SQL queries. Stored procedure will support all type of SQL queries. But function will support only DML operations. So it won't support any other transactions other than DML. So now let's create a procedure. To create procedure, syntax is create. Either you can write proc in short form, or else you can write procedure in full form also, anything is fine. So create procedure, some procedure name. So after that in brackets. So you can mention what are the parameters you require to run that procedure. So if you see, this is very similar to our functions here. So here you are going to see parameters. After that, there will be as, and there will be a begin, and there will be an end. In between, you can write what is the logic of that particular stored procedure. Let me take the same previous example, whatever we work so far, like there is some table called employees, right? We worked at the time of edu.net. So every time, in case if I just want to insert a record into this, every time it is very difficult, I need to write insert into and all this stuff. So instead of that, I am going to create a stored procedure where it is going to be saved in the database permanently, and we can execute it whenever we require going forward. So create, either I can write PROC or you can write procedure also, anything is fine. So procedure, insert employees. So this is nothing but, this is the name of the stored procedure. So to insert records into this particular employee, we require parameters. One is ID, which is of serial number, which is of integer type. The second one is name. These are parameters I am creating, user defined parameters. So some var char of 20 and age parameter, which is of integer type. These are parameters I require. So as, begin and end. Okay, so here I am going to write insert into. If you see this, this is very similar to our edu.net syntax, right? So employees, so here you are going to mention id, name, comma, age. So values, sorry, it's my mistake guys, here you should write the table name. So values of id, instead of passing the static values, here you are going to take whatever the parameters you received to this particular stored procedure, where name and age, invalid column. Okay, I think it's serial number. Like that, you can insert the record. So after insertion, I just want to get the confirmation whether this insertion is successful or failure. So we can write an if else logic here. If there is a predefined attribute, guys, that is what called row count. So where this is going to give you, after performing any DML operation, whether it is insert or update or delete, how many rows inserted or how many rows it is affected, or how many rows it is deleted and all those, that number you will get into this variable, exactly similar to our cmd.execute non-query. Okay, so if this is greater than 0, if this row count is greater than 0, then begin and end. In between, I can write select inserted successfully, inserted successfully as message. Message is a column header. You can see the result is going to be like this. Message is the column name. In short form, I am giving. It is like an alias name for this particular select statement column. So if not else, begin and end, select unable to insert as the same header name. That's it. This is the script. And one more thing, so step 1 and this is step 2. Step 3, I just want to print my table also after insertion. So select star from employees. So if you observe what is the use of stored processor, you can easily understand from this. So this is going to create some, this is going to group some SQL statements, and that is going to be formed as one unit, and that is going to execute at all at one shot. So now if I execute, so the result is going to be command completed successfully. So guys, if you go to this particular database folder, again refresh it. So inside this, you will have these folders, right? There is a folder called programmability. If you open that, there is a folder called stored procedures. So here there is a stored procedure what we created, insert employees. This is being saved in the database permanently. Now whenever I just want to insert a record here, I can simply right click, and here there is an option execute stored procedure. So I can directly execute from this. So for serial number, what is the value I just want to pass? 108. So name is, so age, and you can click OK. So then you can see it was inserted, you got the message inserted successfully, you got the select star, and there is a message. So I mean to say insert is happened, that is step one. So you got the result inserted successfully, and you got the table data also. This is the third one. So this is how, where you can execute it through the mouse, I mean through the graphical representation. So suppose in case if I just want to execute it through the code, through the query, I can execute like this. Guys, whenever I use this two minus or two hyphen symbols, that means the line was commented. So to execute stored procedure, you can use exec in short form of execute, or else you can completely write execute also. And then you can write the procedure name, insert employees is the procedure, and you can pass the values. For serial number, let's pass 110. For name, I can pass Steve, and for age attribute, I can pass some 26. So this is one way. Even if I execute, I will get the same result. If you see, I'm while executing, I'm not selecting this comment. So I'm only selecting this particular syntax so that I can see the result. So it was inserted. Okay. Now, so the other way is, so the same thing, exec, after that procedure name. After that, instead of mentioning the variable values, variable names, directly you can pass the values as per the procedure it is created. So first you have to insert value for serial number, then for name, then for age. Anything is fine. Now you can see this record is also inserted. So this is how you can create a stored procedure. This is how you can execute it. So only one thing you should understand. Suppose after few days, I just want to modify the stored procedure. So what will be the code to get that syntax script, whatever we saved under stored procedure? SP underscore help text. In single quote, pass the procedure name and execute, so that you can get the code of the stored procedure. Here you can click and select that, and you can paste it and modify. Whenever you are modifying, you can simply add alter. So here what I will modify, select star from employee, order by of serial number, that's it. So again, I can select till this alter and execute. It is going to modify. So if you have any doubt, you can execute this one. You can see, so ordered by serial number was included. So like that, you can create a stored procedure, you can execute it, and you can modify it, and you can get the source code of stored procedure also. In case if you want to delete the stored procedure, drop proc procedure name. Drop procedure, procedure name is the syntax to delete the stored procedure. Otherwise, here you can right click and simply select the delete option. Anything is fine. So this is how we can create stored procedures. So I hope it is clear. Now the next one, so that is what called functions in TSQL. So functions are also looks very similar, but only thing is functions need to return a value after its completion. Even if you see our C# programs, you will have void, int, or anything, some return type should be there for functions. So functions will never support DML queries, guys. Maybe I said wrong at the starting, it won't support DML queries. So that is the reason you are not going to use functions much. Functions will be designed for our mathematical calculation purpose or some any other operation calculations. So we are going to use functions. Functions will have a syntax similar. So create function, function name. So after that, as it is, here you are going to have parameters. So here additionally, you will have a line returns. You are going to mention what is the return type. Return type is varchar, return type is integer, or what is what. So after that, as So you are going to have a begin and end. In between, at last you should write return what is the value. So this value should be equal with the return type. So this is how you can create functions. Let us see an example instead of going with the theoretical definitions. So here I just want to create a function where I will pass my annual salary, that will calculate the monthly salary from that. Okay, so create function fn calculate salary. So here you will have only one input, that is what, at the rate annual salary, which is of beginnt data type. So it should returns an integer after the calculation as begin and end. As I said, in between you should return whatever the value you mentioned, it should return an integer. So here I am going to do one thing, return whatever the annual salary we got, annual salary divided by 12, that is going to give you the monthly salary. That's it. This is how we can create a simple function. So if I execute this, so it is going to give you the result, commands completed successfully. So again, come back to the database here, right click and refresh. Again, go to the same folder called programmability. So there you can see a folder called functions. So there we have scalar valued functions. Under that you can see this particular called functions. Guys, you cannot execute it directly even by right click and execute and all those. So to execute functions, there is a proper scenario, understand carefully. So select, so DBO stands for database schema object. Even you can see it here also, DBO dot. So DBO dot, whatever the name of the function that you want to use. So calculate salary of 350,000 example. So now you can see, you will get result like this. So in order to execute function, you should write select DBO dot whatever the function, and you need to pass what is the parameter input for that one. So this is how you can create stored procedure, this is how you can create functions, and you can execute them even in case if you want to get the code of the stored procedure also. So as I already said, sp underscore help text of, you can pass this. So now you can get the code as it is. Here also you can modify by using an alter command. Clear guys, this is how we are going to use TSQL blocks, anonymous blocks. So other than this, the topics whatever you covered so far, joins, unions and functions, everything is same compared with our ANSI SQL whatever you covered so far. So only one topic left in SQL Server, that is what, cursor. I will cover in this next video. Thank you.